So basically, the way I want to start this out is I always describe what the show is. So on this show, I basically just try to talk to some of the pro players, talk to some of the prominent members in the CSGO scene. Usually, it's been North Americans. I guess technically, you could say Steel's European for now, but eventually, he will be bringing his way back to Canada at the end of this month. So he will then be officially North American again. And so it's cool. I try, like I said, I do pro players, I do prominent members of the community. So I just kind of try to get more insight, things you wouldn't normally know or hear or see. Now, I do have to apologize to you, Steel, because some of these questions are going to be repetitive because I know you just did like a really long interview with the SEA News, and I think didn't you do an interview last night with the Go RGN guys? So
Yeah, but there were like mini interviews. They weren't like I was trolling for most of it. I'll give you real answers
oh,
here.
so you saved your good shit for me, is what you're saying.
I guess. I
All
don't
right.
know. I didn't go in depth with anything really. It was just like a more of a post game, and then they started asking me other questions. So, I tried to answer to the best of my ability, but I wasn't really mentally prepared or physically. It was like 3 a.m. that I was doing it.
I
So.
got you. All right. So with that being said, I'm gonna start it out a little bit with Counter-Strike Source, just a brief amount, and that's just because I think that's where you got your name, so to speak, and I think it's how people on this show that are watching maybe don't know anything about Source. Maybe they just started watching during Go. Maybe they were 1.6 people. But essentially, maybe you can just briefly talk about your stint in Counter-Strike Source in North America and how you kind of got a name for yourself as a player.
Okay, it started, I guess, back in 2008 when I actually first started playing competitively. This was just shortly after the demise of tournament.com. I went straight to that from the pubs. So I was playing 24/7 office servers. And then I met someone who lived in Toronto close to me through tournament.com. And then that's how I started playing like IRC scrims, Cal Open with some other local people into the Toronto area. And shortly after, that's how I just started playing in Cal and Sivo. Started playing with a local Toronto team. We went to local Toronto lands. We brought our computers over to my house every like 3 weeks or something, every once a month, and we just had like local lands and got drunk and just had a good time, watched movies, did stupid shit. And then like progressing forwards like a year, I knew that I had more goals in the game than my friends did at the time. I'd call them friends more than teammates. Like we played games, we played the matches and the seasons and everything, but we mainly just dicked around. We didn't actually have our eyes set on anything. And then around that time, 2009 is when I'm just like, I actually want to get better. I was already introduced to ESEA by then, so I was like ESEA pugging, and I had like ridiculously good pug stats. I was going around just like, this was just before Freakazoid time as well, and I was like just getting the most aces and the highest ADR and pugs and whatever. And that's when this is like the first season of ESEA Source. And a team called K2 kind of noticed me. So that was like Zart, Neil, now known as Monty, and a couple of others, Weebs and
Sore.
Sar, yeah. So that was like my first break onto like an actual like proper team. And we played I played the playoffs of ESEA Open with them. And we got second place. We just lost to old X3O, renamed to Dynamic, renamed to, I guess, iBUYPOWER. I don't know. It was AZK's team. AZK, PEX, Legend, a couple of others. I don't know if this was just before Dren time, or this was back when they had Tuned and Solrak still, like ages and ages ago, just before Tuned and Solrak stepped down, then Adrenaline Sunman came in. So this is ancient history. That was like my first like look into the pro scene. Well, not even the pro scene, just like top tier CS. Anyways, they cut me from that team. They said I was shit, so they cut me. And then
Was this Dynamic at DS Rack? You got
no
cut.
no no
Oh, this
no
is
no no no
before that. Okay.
this is I didn't get cut from Dynamic, but we'll get
Yeah,
there.
we'll get there. Okay, that's what I was thinking.
So So this is I was on K2, I was playing with them. They cut me after that season, and then I went back to playing with my friends, taking a tiny bit of experience with me. But then I knew I didn't want that. So what I did is I tried to take a couple of friends with me, and then like kind of get better players as well. So this is when I first started playing with. I tried making a team with a teammate called Yayo and Crew, and then this is when I first started playing with Ryan. Like Zomblers Ryan, and from there I was able to get other players like Neil to play with me, Monty that is, and this is when Nearcry wanted to do the Canadian Revolution thing, so I was building him like a Canadian team that was good, and I got Ryan. He was the only American in the team, everyone else was Canadian, and then slowly I started like asking Nearcry, like, you can't get a top pure Canadian team, that's not gonna work. How many Americans can I have? Shit, that's my alarm. Anyways, so yeah, I was making that team, and then slowly I just shifted from Canadian Rev to Cyber Rev because we eventually moved up to Invite, and then boom, I went from these teams. I made the Cyber Rev with like Schaefer, and then I got into Dynamic, and that's where I actually got into the scene. So it wasn't actually too long. 2008 to 2009 is basically my pub years, and then I started shifting into the pro scene.
Right. So let's talk about that a little bit more. I have like basically two questions about the source scene. So the first one is the infamous stint with Dynamic, where you guys
Okay.
went to DS Rack, and the only team that seemed to beat you guys was Very Games. Like that was, but you guys had literally proved so much about North American Counter-Strike source at that point in time still, because you were beating literally everybody else at that tournament. It was just Very Games that seemed to be kind of the thorn in your side, your kryptonite, so to speak. But so my point is in everyone's eyes, in like the international community, or at least North Americans, we were like, wow, this is like our best source team. Like this team is doing really well. They almost went all the way. Like they almost proved that North America is the best in source, so to speak. But then all of a sudden the team falls apart shortly after DS Rack, and I've heard different rumors about why this has happened, but maybe you can just give your own statement on why that team fell apart, even though they seem to have the most potential.
Okay, so I went to ETS with them. That was my first event with them, like shortly after I was picked up, like I'm talking about a matter of weeks. And we just kind of breezed through it. There's one team that took one map off of us, that was Contra. We won everything else, like every other map was just a blowout. Then we like actually started playing and practicing properly. We did ESCA, we had an undefeated season in Source, including the LAN. But ESCA LAN was kind of the last event together. In between that, we had DS Rack, where we went to Europe. We played fucking well. We had a boot camp and everything, where we just improved so much as individuals and as a team. And we ended up coming second place. We fell short in the finals against Very Games. We played so many more games, and then we were all just tired. I couldn't keep my eyes open at that last game. I played my best on the train, which we only won 16-14, and then boom, right there, like I was out of energy. I was done. I don't know. I can't speak for the rest of my teammates, but from there, it's just like they had the endurance, they had the mental stamina. They ended up going through and winning, and then I learned a lot from there that just it seemed like there was someone on the team that was happy or content with being like just the best in North America and didn't want to kind of be the best in the world and was very stubborn in his ways. And I wanted more. Like I always, anytime I play, I always want more for my team. I want to be better. Like even if we're the best, I want to strive to be even better. Like there's never a point where I'm going to be happy at my level. I'm gonna say, like, obviously everyone knows, like, egotistical Steel, the one that's always saying he's the best. It's because I am, but I always want to be better. Like, I'm never happy with my skill level. I always want to improve. I always see where I make mistakes. I always get pissed off when I make mistakes. I want to get to a point where I don't make mistakes, and I'm always making the right play, which might never happen, but I always want to get. Like, I always want to aim for that. That's my goal. And I feel like it was shared with the majority of the team, but not everyone. So to kind of prove that we weren't gods, we weren't like absolutely the best, unbeatable in North America, you know, just complete gods of the game, I kind of left to build a team that could be better, that didn't limit themselves. And that was the CyberRef team. Originally, it was supposed to be with like Schaefer, who was on a team within the previous season before I got picked up by Dynamic, but that fell apart. That's when I started playing with DaZeD, Frost, TCK, and Marlin. And the first ESCA season back, DaZeD was actually banned from that season. So we had like Monty and Ryan come in instead of Marlin. And we actually beat Dynamic that first season back. And it was nice for me, not because I'm just like, haha, I told you so, or I beat these mortal enemies or anything. It was nice because I had taken a huge risk leaving like the best sponsored team at the time, the best team in North America at the time, the only team in source to compete internationally and since CGS probably. And I willingly left that to go in and make a team that could be better, that didn't really have a financial backing, didn't really have stability, didn't have anything. And we weren't stable for the first bit of time either. But I did it out of principle as opposed to out of anything else. I don't know if I was making a point to someone else or if I was making a point to myself. I just felt that you should never be happy with what you currently are. You should always, like, you should be happy, but you should always strive to be better. And that's what I wanted to do.
So I've always, like, heard another story about this situation where people say that your ego got the best of you and it caused inter-clan turmoil and that's why you kind of left. Does this do you agree with that, or do you think that that's a bunch of shit, basically?
I know that, like, all the shit talking I did on the forums and whatever, that wasn't sitting right with a couple of the members as well as like the sponsor. They wanted to have a different image.
Right.
And I tried to kind of hold myself back a little bit. I think after DSRAC, I think before DSRAC, they weren't happy with me. And then after DSRAC, like my performance and everything, I think they were happy with me. And I don't think they would have removed me, but there was inner team turmoil between me and one other member. And then that has since escalated. But at the time, like if I had just put it behind me and kept playing, I'm sure it would have been fine. But I wasn't happy with kind of who the boss was. It didn't look like it was a well-run team from the sponsor side. Like Johnny, the owner of Dynamic, he was great. I'm talking about like the team captain type thing. So
am I going to have to fish for a name here, or are you just not going to say anything?
I'm sure everyone knows it's PEX.
Yeah, okay. I'm just making sure that I was like, you kept saying this person. I mean, if you don't want to say names, that's fine, but you know, don't feel afraid to either. I know you don't, but so here's my question. So after all this, you know, Dynamic, after, you know, you guys are able to make, I guess you were like temporarily sponsored by Check Six or something like that, especially for that ESWC you went to with DaZeD, and you guys actually once again beat Dynamic there. I think you guys wound up getting beat by one of the European teams. Not Very
Secrets.
Games, it was Secrets, yeah, Angel Dust's team.
Angel Dust's team didn't make it. Seacrest is the current Dignitas, so okay. It was Fetish once, 3K2, and a couple of other source Danish players, but yeah.
Okay. So with that being said, and this comes down to something you may not want to talk a whole lot about, but I think it is relevant to your current situation, is you and DaZeD had a huge falling out in Counter-Strike Source. I'm not 100% sure on the details of that, and maybe you don't want to disclose that, and that's fine, but I'm just curious, like, what actually happened, and if you want to talk a little bit about it, and how did you guys come to amends, so to speak, over it?
So I don't know what other people take out of the situation. I can talk about it from my point of view.
Yeah, that's what I
And
want.
okay, so back in Source, DaZeD was in-game leading for the team in ESEA and in SIVO. But then when he got ESEA banned for that season, I took over the role for in-game leader like through that ESEA LAN that we won. And this was like a month or a month and a bit just before ESWC was happening. And then for ESWC, whenever we played with DaZeD always took over the role of in-game leader. But then I think there was like a split on a team. Half of them wanted me to call, half of them want DaZeD to call. And then it ended up being me calling for ESWC in Europe because I had been in Europe before. And we had different philosophies on the game. So I wanted it to be like, this is Source. This is very different from CSGO. So I wanted it to be like we'd have three people waiting. We would just throw a flash. Now, Source flashes, if you're even turned away, you're blind from it. I wanted to just have three people throw a flash, it pops, and you're in the site, you're killing them and everything. You're just going, boom, and just getting the trade kills and getting in the site and taking advantage of, you know, the 5 versus 2, 5 versus 3 situation you're in. And DaZeD wanted to do more methodical play, slower, bait flashes out, trying to get a kill first, and then you know, look for an easy pick, make it a 5 versus 4 numbers game, bait up the flashes so that the enemy doesn't have counter flashes, then go in and try to like do it a different way. So we had different philosophies, and I said that won't work because European teams they'll run around in wolf packs of two, and they'll flash, kill like flash pop flash you, kill you, and then fall back, and then we're at a disadvantage. It works different in North America, because North America, someone will just run around a corner at you by himself, you'll get the kill, and that's when you need the methodical play. So it was different philosophies on the game style. And then I guess like every time we're in game, I would say one thing and he would want another, and we weren't on the same page, and it just caused a lot of arguments. So that was one of the issues. The other issue was that if, and this wasn't primarily from me, this is Frost and TCK that had the issue with him, is that he would always just go on for a few rounds. If Frost did something stupid, like a bad play, a stupid decision or something, or just like let us get killed because he didn't communicate something, DaZeD would go on for like the next 2 or 3 rounds, just like, I can't believe you let this happen. Like, what were you doing that round? And it got to the point where it was like demoralizing Frost and TCK so much that after the event, we agreed as a team to remove him from the team. Even though he played well, he's a great player, he was an amazing player. We decided to remove him from the team because of just all these inner team issues. And then where I got like, I didn't have an issue with him at this point. I had the issue because, like Check Six, they didn't give us much money to go to ESWC. What I tried to keep kind of private, because it's really nobody else's business, was that I really wanted to go to ESWC, and I was talking about it with my dad, and my dad asked how much would you realistically need, and I told him, and he said, "What if I gave you the money to do this?" And I said, I wouldn't want you to do that. And he said, what if I just did it anyways? So it was actually my dad who funded, I'd say, like a majority of the trip, like shit, like thousands of dollars. So this was, you know, my dad doing something for me and having all this kind of shit go down. Anyways, Dave's made a comment on his on the network code forums saying we'll see how they do at the next Europe competition if Steel's dad pays for it or something along those lines. And that kind of like pissed me off, and I think that was like that's why I was pissed off at him. I don't know what these other stories are
I've heard stories about like a sponsorship debate or something like that.
Like we're speaking to the Razor guy in like backstage, and Dave said like I have a website I'm doing this for, but it would make more sense if we had it as a team, because we're still a team at the time, and it would be good if the like the team had this so that we could go to events. I didn't even know anything about it until like 6 months later, to be honest. Like I didn't know anything about it, so I don't know where that came from at all. But my issue was the like, kind of we went there together, and then he kind of spat in our face, or my face at least, and that's kind of what made me upset. And then we went to Copenhagen Games, which is March. So this is October that we went to SWC. Copenhagen Games was in March. We got about, I think it was like $3,600 prize money from ESWC. So instead of dividing it by five and giving it to all the players as prize money, I used that money to pay for our flights for Copenhagen Games. And at the time, Days obviously wasn't on the team. This is when we were playing with Mo. And Days and Frost actually wanted to get Days back instead of Mo. And then we played with Days for a night and we kind of like squashed the beef. But then he told us the next day that he actually didn't want to do it, but still wanted the prize money from ESWC. And I had said that it was going towards the flights for Copenhagen Games. And he didn't agree with that. He thought it was a different arrangement, but in the end, like everyone else said, like the money came from me, like give it back and I'll put it forward again for Copenhagen Games. So everyone was happy with the decision. So we went to Copenhagen Games with that money instead. And I think that kind of made him feel upset or something. But again, it was put in for the team and it was returned to the team, and it's just that he was removed from the time and the team in the period. So that was our little falling out issue. But then we squashed that. Like we played together the last season of Source at ESEA, and we're beginning to put things behind us then, but we were still like, it wasn't like eye to eye. We weren't completely over things. It wasn't until like a year later after that, which is still like a year ago still, where we actually like squashed things for real and like added each other back to Steam and everything. So like all of this is, you know, last year is when we actually mended everything. The year before that is when we still like played together and kind of like tolerated each other. It was like 3, 4 years ago that, well, I guess it was more like 3 years, 2011 is when we actually had the real issues. So this is like ancient history. It's in the past. And I don't know what other people said. This is how I felt, just because a comment he made. That's basically it.
So how are you able to get past this then? Like you just had like a gentleman's agreement or discussion, like, hey, let's drop this shit. Like how did you guys make amends, I guess? That makes sense.
Well, we were just talking about when we're playing together on a team, like we were just so good together. Even though we had differing philosophies, anytime we did anything together, like we're just a great combination. We always brought different ideas and perspectives to the table. We were always able to give suggestions to each other for a strat. We're always able to make plays, like just be a playmaker when we needed it. So we knew that together on a team, we're just really, really fucking good. So I guess we were talking like as a way to just put shit behind us and kind of put our heads together and just say, you know what? Yeah, we didn't get along for a bit. Yeah, we fell out or whatever. There's no denying how good we can be as teammates. Let's just fucking put all that behind us and play again.
I hear
Like
you.
there's no sense in a little bit of just whatever the fuck went down, it went down. There's no sense in just keeping that between us when we can achieve so much together again in the future. It doesn't make sense. So after that, like it kind of opened the door again to, I guess, get back on iBuyPower, you know, a year into the future.
Right.
It's not something that I or he had planned. It's just, we squashed the beef, and, mm-hmm. and that, I guess, gave the opportunity for this team to now happen.
Right. So before we get to iBuyPower, you mm-hmm. obviously decided to move to Europe early on in CSGO. To play yeah. on some different European teams, mostly iterations of teams that you and Hudge G kind of put together.
Yes.
First of all, what was your – I'm just going to ask like two or three questions based out of this, and you can be quick with it if you want or just talk as much as you want about it. But first of all, I think you've already kind of talked about why you went, something about you just had a passport, you thought it was a great opportunity, you didn't see CSGO doing really well in North America initially. You know, so basically, is this all true, or what really was your motivation to leave NA behind and go overseas to try to play with these Brits, so to speak?
There were many things that motivated me to it, and I do have a UK passport, actually. So that was one of the things. I really enjoyed traveling. I always wanted to see Europe in some form. My brother did like a trip around Europe, like took 4 months off. And he said it was really lovely. So I was always like infatuated with Europe, with Germany specifically. And this is around, this is shortly after Copenhagen Games, like a month or two later. And we still didn't have any like monetary backing for a team. This is when I was building Torqued and I was getting help from like Infusion 3 for creating a website. And we're kind of like taking things forward a bit. And then MTW just approached me and offered me a spot on the team. They said that they had plans for getting a gaming house and everything in Germany. So this would be the financial backing I needed. This would get me to all the big European events. This would allow me to travel. I would be close to, I have loads of family in England. I'd be able to visit my brothers. I had a couple of brothers living in Israel. So right there, like I only had one brother and my parents and grandparents living in Toronto. Most of my other family is living in other places around the world. So I just said to myself, it makes more sense to join a team that has financial backing that can get me to all these events and play with a top team than to kind of dick around trying to figure out how we're going to get to the next ESCA LAN domestically without any other like big things in mind. So I just said to myself, you know what, just fucking do it, have an experience, you get to live somewhere for free, you make money, you can go travel. From Germany, you take a train or a flight that costs, you know, 100 euros or 200 euros, and you can fly to any destination. It was a no-brainer to me, so I did it, and then things kind of were not exactly as I was told they were going to be. And then eventually it did fall apart just because they didn't have the money that they said they had. And this was about 6 months, I think. So I joined them in like May 2012, but I didn't fly over until July or August. And then from, I guess it was around August time until December. So around 4 or 5 months where I was actually in Europe and they said that they had money. I only went to two events. One of them wasn't even funded by them. It was funded by Nearcry mainly. That was when we went to iSeries as the MTW Mouse Sports Mix. And then we went to EPS Germany with MTW. And that wasn't even with Huds G because we needed three Germans for that. We ended up winning that. But like that was like the last event that we went as MTW. We just had issues with people being a bunch of fuck-ups. Like, this Klee guy, he is just the biggest piece of shit I have ever met in this game. Just a pathological liar. Just weirdest guy ever. Anyways, he was the reason why we lost the ESWC qualifier. He decided to show up late on his friend's computer without his config with a 60 hertz monitor. And then he did nothing but flame us the entire game. And we ended up losing in three maps in overtime. That was our trip to ESWC. So after that, we kind of The manager of MTW said there are no more tournaments this year. Take like a bunch of time and wait for someone good to appear. Wait until January. So we were just taking a break. And then in January, he's like, oh yeah, we have no money. So I just bought a train ticket to London because I was talking to my family. My cousins live in London and they said, just come here. You'll have an amazing time. You'll find something to do. So I moved to London. After a couple of weeks, I found a job working in IT. I found a place to live. This box that you guys see, which actually cost me 650 pounds a month. So that's around $1,000. It's expensive in London. It is really expensive in London. But I was living here happily. I had a job. I was making new friends. And I was having a good time. But I was putting most of my time and energy and effort into working full time. Like I'd get home. And when I was playing, I'd have to actually get home from work, not have time to eat, and I'd be on the game, like on the computer playing games. I wasn't too happy with that, so I had to cut down on the time that I had, that I allowed myself to play games. And then this means that I couldn't play at as high a level as I'd like to. So that's when I was like playing with Dignitas and Reason, and the teams weren't that great. Like, as teams, we didn't have enough time to put into it. We had different goals and directions. And then after I finally got settled into the job and I could kind of balance work and play, I started trying to like make teams with Hudsy again. And the latest one, we just lost EMS 1 qualifier. We shouldn't have. We beat ourselves, really. And then after the fact, I find out this player has a problem with this player, this person has a problem with that player, this person has a problem with me. I said, you know what, fuck this. I'm just going to go EMS as the observer. I'm going to get back. I quit my job in this time as well. So I put my notice in where I would have my last day just before EMS 1. So I said, I'm just going to put fucking esports behind. I'm going to do some freelance work here and there for like observing or casting. And then I'm going to focus on just getting a newer and better job. I'm going to kind of step up and do, like I was doing first line desktop support. I wanted to do like first/second line or second line support. And I was going to focus on that. And then EMS 1 happened and I'm like, fuck IT work. I want to be in esports. That's what I want to do. And then, yeah, shortly after, that's when I actually got back into it with iBUYPOWER.
So how are you like going to financially support yourself now since you quit your job? And I mean, I don't know what your arrangement is with iBUYPOWER and such. I know you stream a bit. So is that like your new goal to try to bring streaming forward? Like what is kind of your, I think it's like, I mean, it's crazy. You took that big of a risk to just quit your job and go observe EMS. And then now you're just in this situation you're in now. That seems like really risky to me. So I was just kind of curious what made you decide to do all that and what your plan is.
I don't exactly plan my life. I kind of make these rash decisions. I have a place to live in Toronto. In terms of like money, for the first bit of time, I don't know specifically what I'll be doing. I know it's still, I move back April 23rd. So I have 2 weeks before I actually move back. And then when I actually move back, I got to figure out what's going on with my apartment because I need it, or it's a condo, so I need to figure out like furnishings and everything. After that, I'll kind of figure out what I want to do. I could do things like 4 or 5 week contracts for IT desktop support. Like I have the experience now, I have the references, so I could do that. But I want to try focusing more on casting, commentating. So during the day, my time is like European matches, SLTV, ESEA, all that stuff. I was thinking, what if I got into that on a regular schedule, doing European games and then playing practice at night, where I could balance both. In Europe, I can't do both. I'm either playing or I'm, you know, casting. I can't balance both. But if I'm doing that from, you know, Canada, I can. The other thing is, if I'm in Canada, I'm obviously not going to every European event. So if a European event did need me and my team wasn't going, that would free that up. And now with ESL acquiring ESS agency, we might see more things in North America. So I'll try reaching out to other companies, seeing if companies like that are running something where they need me. Obviously, I don't know if that will interfere because I'll be playing, but the idea was do something esports related and play, or do something IT related and play, but something where I can play and not have other shit interfere with that. Like, I want to be able to go and do a boot camp and travel for a couple of days after the event. I don't want to just go play the entire like week and then fly home. I want to see the place. That's half the fun. I went to Milan for Face It to as a caster, and I had the Monday evening and Thursday like day to kind of just go out and explore Milan, and I got to see so much of it. Like, I ended up having Tuesday and Wednesday for like 6 hours where I was able to explore the place. So it was really good to have that experience, be able to go out and see a bunch of the place. Even in Germany, when I was on MTW, my dad flew up and we went on a road trip together. So we went and saw Berlin, we saw like Cologne and Dusseldorf. Like, we went and we drove to these places and we saw a lot of the country. So having esports kind of as a big thing in my life allows me to go and travel and explore these places. And I really enjoy that. Like, for me right now, I don't care about doing all this other boring shit. Like, I like learning new things, don't get me wrong, but sitting in university and focusing on one thing is boring to me because I don't know what I like. I don't know what I want to do for the rest of my life. So I'm kind of seeing and doing a bunch of things now. And then when I'm older, even though I'm like 24 now, I'd say like 28 type of thing, that's when I really need to focus on what the fuck am I going to do for the rest of my life. Right now, I kind of want to explore and just have a good time.
Right. So I have one question that's going to kind of transition to iBUYPOWER, and it's basically, I mean, at what point did you just realize that you were never going to be able to find like a team in Europe that was going to be successful? Was it just after this last iteration that you had for the qualifiers that you just realized there's nothing left for me to do? I mean, was there no other team you could have joined or other group of players you could have gotten with? Like, what made you finally give up on trying to compete in Europe?
I think I knew for a while. I was just in denial. Not denial of the organization, but like
I was able to read that.
I just like I still like it here. I love it in London. I was working a really good job. I made new friends, and I guess that was keeping me here over games. But now, like after being at EMS1, I'm just like, you know what? It doesn't work. You don't have a top English speaking CS team. They're all either French, Russian, German. Well, not German, but you know what
I
I
get your
mean?
point.
Swedish, Swedish,
Yeah, Swedish
Swedish,
was good.
Swedish.
Swedish, yeah,
So
Sweden forever.
there are no top UK teams, period. And then international teams don't work because you'll have two people speaking a different language that could make a better team if they went and had like a full Swedish team instead of picking up two
Right.
Swedish players to speak English. It just doesn't work. You don't have top UK players. The top UK players that do have the time and dedication and skill level to actually play don't get along with each other or rat people out for better offers. They just better deal everyone. So there's all sorts of issues within the UK scene. There aren't enough good English speaking players here that can just settle down, play the game, and commit to a schedule or anything. So it was kind of like a bunch of I can't even speak, lackluster teams that we're trying to like kind of build. But it reminds me of the Jenga picture. There's like Jenga bricks, and it was like being held on by like one brick, and it said still more stable than MTW, and that made me laugh. But it's true, like. It's not a thing. You can't have a good English team in Europe. It doesn't exist.
So you'll never, we'll never see a UK team that's worth a shit and go, is what you're, is that what you're telling me?
Not in the next like year, at least.
All right.
At least. And it's been a year already. It's been 2 years, man. And yeah, Nexus was the closest shot. And yeah, they were shocking. They were shocking.
I hear you, man. So that leads me to now iBUYPOWER, of course. So how did this, how did the conversation start about you joining this team? Like how did it go down, man? Take me from day one of your communications to you actually joining the team.
I was like at the airport, I guess. I was talking at the Twitch after party. On the Saturday at the event, I was talking to Adren, and he's like, yeah, I'm stepping down. I said, oh yeah, what are you doing? He said, I'm working IT desktop support. I said, oh, I was doing the same thing. So we were talking about that. And then I just kind of jokingly said to Daze, like, Adren's stepping down, so when are we squatting up? And then again at the airport a couple days later, I saw them. I'm like, who are you guys getting as a fifth? And we weren't actually talking about anything there, but I saw a tweet by iBUYPOWER saying like Adren was stepping down and stuff. I said, let me know when you want to squad up. And then they favorited that. And then I guess like I messaged Daze a couple days later and said, what are you guys actually doing? Would you want, like, would you need me? And it's like, yeah, we're just talking about things. I'll let you know in like a day or two or something. And then I saw shit about like anger tweeting like all this emo crap, and I saw forums talking about shit, and I didn't know anything at the time. I didn't know what was going down. And then they basically said, yo, so I think we're playing with swag. We want you to be our fifth. And I'm like, okay. That's how it happened.
That's like, it.
I was left in the dark for most of it. I let the team kind of deal with whatever they needed to deal with. I didn't like weasel my way in to get anger out of there, if that's what people are thinking. I had made it clear that I wouldn't play with him. But,
well, you guys hated each other. You guys still hate each other, so it's not really like a shocking
He's just a two-faced, lying... he'll pretend to be nice, overly nice, like everywhere he is, forums and streams or whatever the fuck. But and at LAN, he's like the sweetest guy ever. And then he'll message you on Steam and call you faggot nigger Jew, I hope you die, you're a piece of shit, and then deletes you and blocks you. And then 2 months later he re-adds you and is like, yo, I'll get you a beer at ESLN. Like what the fuck, man? So that pissed me off. And then
I just remember kind of... your Twitter war where you were basically making a joke about, I guess,
yeah,
doing better than him on Dynamic or something, and how he wasn't a fit replacement
for
you.
Something some about shit like that. Shoes.
You look like the dick in that situation, to be completely fair.
I said, you never could feel my
shoes. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. You were basically being a huge dick. Like, let's be completely honest here.
That tweet was funny as fuck.
But you were a dick. Like, let's be real.
That was a funny fucking
tweet. You looked like the bad guy in that situation for
Come
sure.
On.
But you did look like the bad guy.
How funny was that tweet?
It was funny because of how, like, mean it was. Like, because, I mean, I've always had a pretty... Like, I like to say I have a pretty good relationship with all the pro players, with the exception of a couple who hate me. I don't know why they hate me. They just do. I guess they find me annoying or whatever because I'm asking them for interviews and shit. They don't like that. But anyway, so I try to, like avoid drama like the plague, because as a commentator, you kind of have to have relationships with everyone because you never know when you might... like need someone for something like an interview, or, you know, you have to commentate their matches and you have to interact with them at these events. So, you know, like you have to like have a professional like relationship with everyone. You don't want to piss anybody off because then they're not going to want to work with you ever. and that kind of can cause problems. So I, as like a commentator, have to kind of remain neutral in almost every situation. There's only been two occasions where I have taken a side on something, and that was probably bad on my part, even to this day. So I try to stay out of it. But those tweets, man, you look like a dick in that situation. That's the bottom line. But that's kind of the reputation that you have, I guess. I don't know. It is what it is. Leave it at that.
I thought it was funny. Anyways, yeah, no, he definitely didn't take it the right way and kind of started escalating it. So I just re-escalated it, whatever. But yeah, no, I didn't like him as a player. I wouldn't have enjoyed having him as a teammate just because of his play style. He's good against bad teams, basically. So I didn't think he would ever be able to compete at a top international level just because he crumbles against good teams. It's as simple as that. So I didn't want to play with him, all personality issues aside. But, yeah.
All right. So here's my question. Is you claim that you were completely in the dark about the whole complexity of iBUYPOWER drama. I find this really hard to believe, but if that's what you're going to say, that's what you're going to say. But like, even after the fact, now that you've been on the team for a while, has it never come up like, yo, Swag, like, why did you leave Cole? Like, why are you on iBUYPOWER now? Like, has that never been, like, a topic of discussion on, like, why this roster change happened the way that it did?
After you're the hype with Hiko?
Yeah. Because we got Hiko. Like, here, let me preface this really quickly. So, okay. I did an interview with Hiko a few weeks ago. It was episode, I guess, what, 7 of the hype? This is episode 8. And in that interview, like, obviously that was like hot news that had just happened. I interviewed Hiko, I think maybe 2 or 3 days after like Swag joined iBUYPOWER. So it was like fresh news. And in that interview, Hiko essentially said, yo, you know, we don't really know what the hell happened. We got back from Poland. We're hearing rumors that Swag wants to leave and go to iBUYPOWER. We had, I guess nothing was kind of the mediator. Jordan was the mediator between like the rest of the team and Swag because It was like very apparent that Jordan and Swag were like the closest like to each other compared to everyone else on the team because they had played together for so long. Every GO team so far, except for now, they've been together, so they had a really close relationship. And basically, all that I ever heard from Hiko was that, you know, nothing was like, yeah, I'm talking to him, he's telling me he's leaving, and he basically never really gave a reason why he wanted to leave. He kind of just abandoned the team, according to Hiko. So, unless you're about to lay the smack down on the other side of the story, that's all I have to go by, man. So, do you have anything for me on that?
I asked him, like, have you spoken to the guys yet? Like, I think we're trying to, like, schedule a match with Complexity or a scrim or something. I'm like, yo, Brax, why don't you just message one of them? Why don't you just message Hiko? And he's like, I can't. He deleted me from Steam. I'm just like, what the fuck? So I don't know. I honestly didn't really read into it. This is before I joined. Like this, I think iBUYPOWER wanted Swag before me, and I don't hold that against them. And yeah, this is before me. I didn't really ask him too much. I asked him why he left the team. Like they were doing well. He told me something about just the skill of the team. I don't really want to go into it too much. It's not my place to really talk about it. I think he just wasn't happy for his reasons and he decided to leave. That's the extent that I know. I don't want to say too much about his side of the thing because that's not my spot. If you want to get him on the hype,
I have tried to get Swag on the hype and he refused.
Did you ask his mom?
I didn't ask his mom. Maybe
that's your problem. You need to. Yeah.
No, but I did call his mom. Okay, so here's what I did. So because everybody wants to hear his side of the story, right? After they heard the Hiko interview, and I knew that was going to be the case. So I messaged Swag, and I'm like, yo, man, do you ever want to be on the hype? Blah, 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 blah. And he's like, literally his direct quote was something along the lines of, nah, bruh, I hate that kind of shit. I'm just a player, bro. I don't do those kinds of things. And I was like, okay, well, do you at least want to give me some type of, like, text statement that I can, like, read on stream? Like, you don't even have to be on. You can just give me, like, a statement, and I can, like, read it out, and it'll be your side of the story. And he didn't even respond to that at all. He just ignored that message. So I've tried to get it from the person that needs to say it, but he refuses. So I have to weasel my way around his teammates to get an answer, it seems like. So, but you've
Shame.
got nothing for me.
You should get dazed on the hype then.
DaZeD hates me, okay? I am actually,
Why
I'm
does he hate you?
still.
I thought you were trying to keep positive relations with all the pro
I
players. What's
was,
going
but for
on with
some
that?
reason he finds me annoying and doesn't like. He permabanned me from his Twitch chat the other night, and ever since then I haven't spoken to him. Apparently, he got mad because back before they had officially announced who was going to be on iBUYPOWER, me and a bunch of people in his chat were like throwing around our theories, like theory crafting who we thought it would be. And apparently, I was being like too trolly about it because I kept naming all
Well,
these names and stuff. So that probably bothered him.
I think someone had given you maybe a tiny bit of insider knowledge, and you were keeping that from people, but you kept posting on the forums still. When I was reading it, I'm like, how the fuck does he know?
No, I theory crafted this on my show with Hiko. That's where it all
Oh, you did?
started. Yeah.
Okay.
Because here's the thing. No one. Okay, so here's the true statement. Like, this is the honest truth about this whole situation. Okay? I knew about swag, 100%. I was told that beforehand, basically. Once basically it got stated that, like, swag was being released from his contract with Cole and stuff like that, at that point. I think at that point everybody knew that swag was going out by power. Like, it was pretty obvious at that point. So, but as far as with you, I did not know that you were going to join iBUYPOWER up until like the day after the Hiko interview. That's when I found out for 100% sure that you were going to be on the team. Now, I'm not going to say how I found out because it might get someone in trouble, like in a lot of serious trouble, so I don't want to get those people in trouble. But yeah, so
I could
basic
probably figure out who it was anyways.
I mean, I'll tell you who it is after it's over. But the point is that like me and Hiko were sitting there hashing things out, like who can iBUYPOWER pick up? Who's gonna be their fifth? And I was like, well, I would think DaZeD would want to pick up somebody he's played with before, somebody that is LAN proven, that has experience, that he knows works well with the team. And
Stop. You're making me blush.
I mean, you were the logical, like, who else was he going to pick up? I mean, he had already grabbed somebody from Cole, and Cole is the only other team in North America that has, like, LAN-proven players, besides, like, maybe United 5, like some of these, like, old-school 1.6ers or whatever. That was really the only group of LAN-proven people, and if you're iBUYPOWER and you want a team that's instantly possibly going to have LAN success, your best option is to pick up a LAN vet. And so it was either you or, like, maybe a Dborn or an Irukandji. Like somebody else he had played with that had like a real lot of 1.6 experience. So that's what I narrowed it down to. I narrowed it down to the three people, you, Irukandji, and Dborn. And I think it winds up being you. I don't know if he ever talks to other people or not. So it's whatever. If he's mad about that or other people are mad about that. I admit I was a bit of a dick on the forums and maybe I should have kept my mouth shut. Maybe I shouldn't have trolled as much as I did. But yeah, so
I'm
it is
turning
what it
you into
is
the
though.
bad guy here.
I
I
was a
love
bad
it.
guy. I was
I'm
being
kind of,
I was being. See, he got
I'm
mad at
normally
me
the bad
based on
guy.
Twitch chat. And Twitch chat, like everyone was saying shit, so it was like I didn't think it was a big deal, but I probably should have kept my mouth shut on the forums. It's whatever. Past is the past. But so the point is now you find yourself joining iBUYPOWER, and what are you thinking to yourself when you see this roster? Because obviously you've played with DaZeD before. Obviously you've seen them play. Are you seeing what swag can do? You see what all these players can do, I guess, at some point or another. So, what is kind of your thoughts going into this team?
About to own the scene.
So, how long do you think it's realistically going to take for you guys to be ready to do owning the scene?
Owning the
Because
scene? With complexity, I think we're already in the position that we can do it. Obviously, we're a new team and we're kind of like building everything out. Like, we're building the foundation still. But I think just based off of individual skill, we shouldn't have a problem maintaining like our composure right now. I think that having complexity kind of have to redo everything that they have is going to hinder them a bit. And I think that at the moment, we're on top of them. All we have to do is remain on top of them. So domestically, I don't think we should have an issue. It's internationally. But I don't think the next international turn, I guess ESEA, depending on how many Europeans
yeah,
show up.
right. That's at the end of
So
June.
that's our goal. So April, May, June. We have like 2 and a bit months to kind of get to that level where we can compete at the top internationally. That's our goal. So 2 months to do it. We've been playing together for just shy of a month. I'm sure we could get to that point by USCA LAN.
So why do you think Complexity is having such a harder time trying to adapt to their new team as opposed to you guys when you guys actually made more roster changes than they did? You made two, they only made one. I guess granted yours, I think your roster situation was kind of voluntary, like this is what like the team wanted, whereas like Complexity I guess kind of got forced into their situation because Swag left and wanted to leave, and so they were forced to find a new fifth. So, like, why do you think, is that maybe why they're struggling more? Because it was like an involuntary thing for them, whereas for you it was kind of voluntary. Like, why is Cole struggling and you're not?
Are you trying to make me bring the hype?
What do
I
you?
can.
I want you to tell me why you guys are doing fine and Cole's struggling. Because here's the point, and I've been making this point for 3 weeks. Is that there is a very real chance that Cole doesn't make it to ESEA LAN. It's a real chance. Because here's why. They already have 4 losses, right? They play you guys next week. So let's say that you guys win that, and now they're down to 5 losses. We know how this works. You have to have an 11-5 record, I think, to guarantee it most seasons. Like, granted, it all depends on how the other teams perform. But usually, what I've always seen in the past is like, if you have an 11-5 record, you're pretty much guaranteed a slot at LAN. But if you're 10-6, there's a chance you fall into like a tiebreaker. 9-7, you're definitely in a tiebreaker situation to get a 4th spot. So if they do lose to you guys next week, they're 1 or 2 losses away from potentially not making the event. So why is this the case? Why are they struggling and you guys are winning? You guys are winning. You've only lost once since you've been on the team, I think.
I think it could be a mix between just kind of having to redo everything, but it could just be a bad beat. They got bad beat by one or two teams. It happens. It happens to all of us. I know that mediocre gamers, we played them. They beat us. They beat us in the first time we scrimmed them after that on Dust 2, they smashed us. But then we played Dust 2 against them again and we smashed them back. So I think it's just getting your footing against all different types of play styles. And the first time you go against it as a team, you're kind of just going to falter that first time. And then you're going to be able to beat them the next time you play that certain style on that map. And I think they need to find their footing in that respect. I think that what their issue is right now, hype intro, please, is that they picked anger as their fifth out of, I think it was like a forced decision, just because he was the best option available at the time. I don't think they necessarily got him because they thought he was like super good or would fit in with their play style immediately or anything like that. I think they got him because he was the best option at the time and they needed someone, anyone, and now they're trying to make it work with him. And I think that's what their issue is at the moment, kind of revamping everything based off of their new set of rules, their new composition as a team. And they can find their footing. They can make it to ESEA land, but I don't think they'll be as strong as they once were, to be honest.
Do
I
you
don't
think
think.
that'll ever change? Like, do you think they could ever be as strong as they used to be?
Not with that composition, not with, well, I'm just going to say it, not with anger.
So, what would it take for them to be dominated again, in your opinion? Let's be real, they have been the most dominant North American team internationally.
Internationally, yes. I think as a strat caller, Sean's doing a great job internationally, kind of leading his team against the top European teams. But I think he can't be the only one kind of bringing this insight to the team. They need someone else that can kind of play individually and kind of think for themselves. I don't think Anger's the type of player that can really do that for himself. They need someone that can kind of think for themselves. Wouldn't say like a strat caller or anything like that. I would just say someone who's more competent playing individually against top teams that can kind of make better decisions.
Okay. So with that being said, I mean, when you guys do face each other at ESCA LAN, if y'all do both make it, I mean, realistically, how do you think that's gonna go?
If we face them at ESCA LAN, same way it's going online, I guess.
Well, we'll find out next week, right?
We'll find out next week, but ESCA LAN's 2 months away.
Yeah.
So maybe they find their footing. Maybe I'm completely wrong about their team, about anger. And maybe they come back and beat us. Can it happen?
So
Probably won't, but it can.
do you still see them as an international contender?
Yeah, I don't see like I'm not ruling it out as a possibility. They can still do very well internationally. They can still do very well domestically. I just don't think that I think it was a step backwards that they did, losing swag. And I think that we will be the better team in the long run. So that's not saying like they're shit. They're still going to be a really top team. Like Kiko's a really good player as well. They have the proper leadership. I think they can do well, but I don't think they'll. I think we'll do better, is what I'm saying.
So here's another just like random question that's kind of related is I think honestly you guys like to be able to do well internationally, you guys need good quality practice, and obviously the best practice that you guys can get would really be against each other. Will that ever be able to happen now with the drama that is between you guys at this point? I'm sure there's bad blood with the whole roster transactions. So I mean, is that something you guys will ever be able to get past to be able to practice against one another? I don't know.
We played them in a practice game, I think it was last night or the night before. It's all a blur to me, really. I don't think, like, if you're asking if we're gonna blacklist one another from practice,
'Cause that's happened in the past, let's be honest.
it has happened in the past. Like when I was still in North America, I know that was happening. I honestly don't know. It's not for me to say. I guess it's I'm happy with playing them. I don't think anyone else on my team has a problem with playing against them. So I guess it's up to them if they want to play against us. And so far, there's nothing kind of suggesting that they wouldn't want to play against us in a scrimmage. So as of right now, there's no issue. I don't know why it would change. Because of a few comments I made towards one of their players, probably not. It should be fine. Like, I don't see an issue.
So here's my question then is, I mean, obviously you guys have 2 months. I'm assuming like, I mean, once you move back to Canada, I mean, are you guys planning on like trying to, because right now I know practice is kind of strenuous for you because of your timetable and stuff like that. Once you make it to Canada at the end of this month, I mean, do you think that you guys will be able to put in a shit ton of practice? Like, I don't know about like maybe boot camping, like online. I don't really know how what you would label it as. I mean, but do you think you're going to get the preparation that you need to be successful at ESCA LAN, because that would be your next LAN event, unless you do one of the other events.
I think now with like SIVO getting more serious, Iron Gaming and like the SoCal LAN and Vegas LAN and everything, I think there's going to be more opportunities for online practice. We're not obviously going to be able to do like a proper boot camp just because teams only play in a certain window. It's like 8 p.m. Eastern until like midnight are the core hours. I'm sure you'll find teams playing outside of those hours, but it's very rare, and so we're going to be limited in that respect. But I think right now our priority is focusing on kind of getting our footing on all the maps, building a foundation, and then once we have a foundation, once we grind down like our teamwork, our chemistry, and we've got solid working defaults in every map, that's when we can create set strats. I don't think that it's good to try the set strats and make sure they work and tweak them out. But I think the most important bits are kind of getting our footing right now as early as possible. And we're doing that through playing two different leagues. We're doing that by just practicing whichever practice we can find online. I don't think that we're gonna, I don't know if we're planning to go like super hardcore when I get back or not. I don't know what will change besides the fact that I'll actually be able to kill people again, which will be nice. We can play Texas servers, which would be nice. And I won't be drowsy as hell, kind of trying to whisper at 3 a.m, which is nice. I don't know what else will change, honestly. Only time will tell, really.
I mean, how, like, okay, so going back to that, how hard of a life decision has this been to, you know, pack up, leave Canada, go to, I mean, obviously you love the experience, you already discussed, like, how it was a great idea for you to move to Europe, and you probably won't regret that at all, I'm sure. But moving back, right? Like, is this a tough decision to move back? Like, I mean, you're, I mean, this is like a big life choice, quit your job, moving back to Canada. Do you think it's really worth it just to play for iBUYPOWER to have made all these crazy life choices?
Most people are crazy. Has he do it? Has he afford it? All these other things. I think that the actual decisions I make aren't too, like, wild or anything. They are, well, I guess they are pretty wild. I don't know. I don't regret anything. I enjoy it. Obviously, it's like packing up and moving and everything. You need to be resilient. I think that it doesn't affect my life as much as it should. And maybe that's because I'm fucked up psychologically. Who knows?
I think that's a pretty safe bet.
Yeah. So maybe I'm just a huge mentalist. Maybe I'm mentally fucked up and it doesn't affect me when it should.
I don't know, dude.
No, I mean,
here's my ultimate question. The reason why, yeah, I'm asking this, let's say iBUYPOWER doesn't work out. Let's say it goes to shit, right? Just worst case scenario, playing devil's advocate. What would you do at that point? I mean, you've uprooted, you've quit your job. And would you just try to find another team? Would you just go into more IT shit? I mean, like, what would you do? I mean, are you cashing in all your chips on this iBUYPOWER thing, or what is it?
There's always opportunities available, is what I've learned in my experiences the past couple of years. If they cut me or if whatever happens, like, obviously I'll be gutted. I probably, like, of all the teams that can compete at a top level, it would kind of limit it down to complexity, and I don't think they'd want to play with me. So I'd probably be out of playing CS, that's for sure. But where I close a door on some opportunities, I open them on others. That frees up my time massively. I'm now no longer kind of restricted to needing weekends off all these times. I can do shit during the evenings. So whether that be I go into full-time work again, like IT work, I can go back to school, I can do commentating, observing full-time. Like, I can build up a channel like Anders is doing on his. So I can do other things. I don't know what. I don't know what I want to do as a career. I don't know what I want to do as the rest of my life. I want to do what I enjoy right now, and that's playing games, and that's, like, freelance stuff, casting, observing, and in whatever free time I have, learning new languages and learning IT shit. So, like, using VMware on my computer and building a Windows server. That's what I'm doing right now. Anything else is kind of, it's not my primary focus, so I don't really consider them. But if something goes down, I'll always find a backup plan. That's my life. Same shit happened to me to move to London in the first place. If you told me 2 years ago, rather, you'll be living in London, working a full-time job in IT as desktop support, I would have said, fuck off. You're shitting me. I had zero experience. I had zero qualifications. I had nothing. I wasn't living in the country. I would have just been like, that's bullshit. I don't believe you. Lo and behold, I was doing it for 13 months. You never know what's going to be around the corner. You never know. So I'll be gutted. I'll find something.
How did you get into IT, by the way, just out of curiosity? You didn't have any experience. I mean, was that something you did, like, in school, or, like, was it just random, just out of curiosity?
from my childhood. So like I grew up with computers. Computers were around me all my life. My dad was heavy into computer software. My brothers are 4, 6, 8 years older than me. I have three older brothers, so they always had computers and shit around when I was younger. I liked breaking things and then fixing them. I've always liked fixing things and breaking things and fixing them again. And I've always just been kind of natural when it comes to problem solving and troubleshooting when it comes to computer software, anything really. So I kind of played that, as well as I refereed soccer for 6 years. So I had some sort of, I guess, tact going into situations with difficult customers. And I think my employers were happy to take on someone who didn't have a whole lot of experience or skills, technical skills at the time, and then build that person up, i.e. me. So I just played on the fact that I'm a quick learner and I'm personable when it comes to, like, if people come in and need something done or whatever the case may be, I'm not a robot just sitting there like, give me problem, I will fix. Like, I don't do that. Like, I speak to the people. So I think that's what they were looking for, and they went with it, and they didn't fire me.
Didn't fire you. That's a good
I
quote.
made it past my 6 month probation and went on for another 7 months after that. Who would have thought? I'm not gonna lie though, I was pretty shit the first few months. I was really bad at the job at the first, like, I wouldn't say the first few, I'd say the first 2 months at least, but then I picked up and I started, like, once I learned everything the first time, I kind of just owned everything else after that. Like, I just fucking owned it.
Going back to fucking owning it, let's get back to CS. Are you really
Back
the
to
best
CS.
player? Is that really your opinion? You really think you're the best?
Of course. The
Really?
fucking best. I'm the
You're the
fucking best.
best.
Are you asking me, are you talking about personality steal, or are you talking to Josh right now?
I don't know. I didn't know you had multiple personalities. Is that something else
It's
I need to worry about now? Is that what you're telling me?
not multiple personalities, it's stream Josh, or it's
Give me
real
both.
life
Let's make it
Josh.
really easy. Just both,
Of
I
course
don't
there are
know.
people that are better than me at the game.
Okay.
Like, if I'm the best, I'll still want to improve. But it gives me something to play towards, and it gives something for it. It gives me something that I can kind of say to other people, so that they get, I don't know if they get intimidated or worked up. They get angry, that's for sure. When I say I'm the best, oh my God, the amount of people that just write and comment on that, like, no, you're not, you're shit, you're so bad at the game, oh my God, how can you think that, you're so noob, you're such an asshole, you're such a d I just sit there and fucking laugh, honestly. There are players that are better than me. There are players that I learn from. I try to learn from every player, really. And it's not kind of looking at the best players and taking things that work from them. It's looking at good and bad players and taking and analyzing what they're doing and why they're doing it and how it would work in certain situations. And then I take that and I try it. And if I think that it's going to work, 70% plus of the time, I'll add it to my repertoire. I'll always strive to improve. I'll always strive to be better. But and w when I'm playing with my team, like, I'll always give them praise for making a nice shot or a nice play, doing good work. That's really important to have in a team as well. And when I'm with my team, I'd never really say I'm better than you, so listen to me for this. It's when I'm talking to other players and other teams or on the stream that I'll say, I did this because I'm the fucking best.
I hear you. So here's
And
my
in
question.
interviews, it
So here's
builds
here.
hype, man. It builds shit. It
It does.
builds
You're
a
the center of
story. It builds
drama.
fun.
Sorry. So here's the deal. iBUYPOWER's gone to 2 trips to Europe. They've been knocked out in groups both times. What the hell makes things any different with you?
What the hell makes things different with the exclusion of anger? I won't go there.
No, you're gonna go there.
I don't know what, like, I wasn't analyzing their games. I don't know what specifically went wrong. What I could probably say is, they probably had DaZeD as like the single and only vocal person on the team at the time. You can't have people go quiet and not give any input as well. I think that's kind of what made me a candidate over other players to
So,
be the fifth player for the team because I can give that input. I didn't know, like, when I was joining, I didn't know that he wanted me to be in game leader. But it helps having two people kind of talk, communicate, like, not even just saying you see a flash go off or you see an enemy somewhere. It's reading the game as well, saying, I hear them going here. I think they're about to do this. Let's do this adjustment to stop it. And if you have two of those players on a team as opposed to one, you're going to be like infinitely times stronger. Just that being a better defense, being a better offense, you can make quicker adjustments. If one of us die during the round, another one of us can pick up and kind of take the lead that round. If I'm too busy stuck on one train of thought and he and Day sees something, he can just be like, he can just take control of the round. And having that dynamic is just something that you don't have with one person, one really vocal person.
I'll kind
And
of
then,
challenge you a bit though, right here,
okay.
is because I think Adrin was very vocal on that team, and it definitely was kind of a second t like he was kind of an in-game leader a lot of the time, and I witnessed this personally at ESEA Land. So I'm curious, like, what you think is different than between the Adrin DaZeD dynamic of them both being in-game lead like roles together, and then like you and DaZeD like are kind of having a similar situation.
Yeah. Well, I know that like when I was playing with Adrenaline on Dynamic, he was really vocal as well. And he made a lot of big plays, but I think that the issue he was having is that he was kind of losing motivation moving towards his full-time career. And kind of I'd say deter like he it's no you can look at his play style, you could look at his stats, whatever you want to look at. In Source, I would say Adrian was like the best player, hands down, bar none, in North America at the very least, if not the world. Like, he was just fucking incredible. He was communicating, huge impact with the AWP, he could rifle, great clutcher, great teammate, always like you asked for a flash, he would throw it. I think the transition to CSGO and losing like the dynamic family and kind of losing one player to this team, one player to retirement, one player here, one player there. I think that's what kind of was eating away at him in terms of individual skill. And I think that's something that's kind of revitalizing me. So I'm coming back from like full-time work, getting back into the game because this is where my motivation is, and it's the opposite for him. So while he might still have been giving a good input and good insight, I don't know if he was still able to make the same amount of impact as a like maybe he had the input as for strategies, but if people that know me and my play style, I actually just go in and try to make plays whenever I can, and I think that might have been lacking from him. Maybe it's because he moved from an AWP to rifle back to AWP. I don't know what it was, but he wasn't as impactful as he was in Source, and that's not a surprise. That's indisputable.
So here's another question I have is I've heard this from several different people, and this is not to take shots at him when I say this, but Skidoo is obviously a very good player. It's one of the best ops in North America, if not the best op in North America. And he definitely can make plays with a rifle too. We saw him do that at ESEA Land a lot. But I've always heard this criticism about him being kind of quiet, and that kind of affects the team, because I think DaZeD even made this comment once in an interview he did with Thorin, where he was saying, it was either an interview with Thorne or an interview with Corey Dunn. I can't remember which, but he made the comment something along the lines of, this is not a direct quote or anything, but he basically said, Skidoo is a really smart player. He reads the game really well. If he would just open up his mouth more, he'd make the game so much easier for the rest of us. So, I mean, is this true? Is this a problem? If so, is it being like worked on? What is your thoughts on that whole idea?
I made him use voice activation.
Instead of press to talk? Seriously?
Yeah. And it's working, actually. It's working. It's he's talking like when I've the first like 2 days on the team, like I'd just be like, Scott, what are you doing? Scott, what are you doing? Like I'd be dead and I'd be spectating, and he would be doing like a play or something, like completely fine play to make, but he was doing something and he wasn't talking to his team. So I'm like, Scott, what are you doing? Scott, what are you doing? Scott, what are you doing? And he thought I was like judging him or something he thought he was doing something wrong. I'm like, no, just say what you're doing on your team, man. So I think just having us kind of ask him what he's doing, so he just says it and gets in the habit of saying what he's doing, whether it's like a massive play or just like a small rotation, as long as he's just vocal about whatever it is, he doesn't have to press a button now, he just has to say it. I think that's helped him a lot. As long as he just says what he's doing, like he doesn't miss shots, man. He doesn't miss a fucking shot. Like this guy just fucking shoots people in the head and like it's breathing or something. I don't know.
Somebody told me that he was born to be a gamer. Is this true?
He's just in the zone all the time, you know? You can't get a doodle out of the zone.
So with that being said, what do you think the projection of this team is? I mean, we've kind of already talked about you think domestically you're on top right now. Maybe that could change, maybe not. And you said you haven't really analyzed the passive iBUYPOWER, so you're not really sure what the direct issue was previously. It seems like preparation wasn't the issue because they boot camped a lot. But either way, I mean, what's your projection now on the team? I mean, you pick up a really strong lurker and swag. You're another entry fragger they add to the arsenal. Dazed and Skadoodles. I mean, well, Dazed is no longer in-game lead, I guess. I'm sure he's helping you with that. But his actual gun in-game mode is still dynamic, able to do a lot. Sky's now back to main opping. I guess AZK is kind of an entry fragger with you at times. So I guess really the roles didn't change a whole lot, except you added a lurker by having swag, and you added like a new in-game lead element to the team. What do you think about it?
One of the biggest things that I think will be a help is Skadoodle's opping again. And I think, so Adrenaline had that role, but like what you have is Dazed, Source Opper, AZK, Source Opper, Adrenaline, Source Opper, Skadoodle, Call of Duty. But let's forget about that for a second.
Okay.
Of all of them, like I think Skadoodle would be the prime candidate for an Opper. I think having, you know, four Oppers kind of have three of them shift back to a rifle, it's going to hurt them. I've always been a rifler. I switched to Op to play with MTW in Europe. Like, I've never been an Opper. I was able to do all right with it, but rifling is basically my life story. So I think bringing in, like, an actual rifle is a benefit. Moving Scar back to Opping is a huge perk. Like, he hasn't missed shots with that thing. You peek him, you're dead. Like, he's just so quick. I just don't know. I don't know. I don't understand. What? Is he human? What the fuck? So
why do people take stabs at him that he's not able to necessarily always reproduce that type of impact on land? Because people used to call him out for that in the past, and I think he's steadily improved over time on land. Yeah. Like, the last event, he was nuts.
People said the same thing about Dazed.
I know, exactly. I brought that up in the past, actually.
Yeah. And I, like, by playing with Dazed and having him, like, strat call or give input, insight into the game, I knew that he was able to read the game. So I knew that he wasn't, like, wall hacking or anything like that. I knew he wasn't cheating. It was just finding the right composition of players, the right team to kind of go to land with and do well with. And when he was still in his like onliner status, whatever stage, I was kind of defending him, saying like, no, like he's going to be good on land. And then lo and behold, ESWC rolls around, the one where he went with, I think it was Quantic. Like, everyone's like, oh my God, Day's best player. And I'm just like, okay. And I think it could be the same thing for Skadoodle. I don't know what it is specifically about him that where he doesn't replicate it to LAN. I haven't been there to watch him. I've never actually taken too much time to actually look at the team, why they did poorly. I never looked individually at each of the players and kind of figured out why they played like shit, when they played like shit, all I can do is play with them at the next LAN or boot camp before LAN and kind of figure out what it is that he's not comfortable with and kind of help him with it. But until we get to that point, I don't think that, I think all we're doing right now is just talking shit. We, only time will tell, really. We'll have to get to the LAN, and then from there I can look at things, analyze it, assess it, fix it.
So with that being said, realistically, how do you think you'll do at ESCA LAN come June? Because that's really the next big event for you guys.
Didn't he do well at the last one?
Yeah. I just meant how do you think your team will do, not him. How do you think your team will place?
I think domestically we shouldn't have an issue. It depends on which European teams come over, and it depends on how much practice we can get beforehand. I don't see why we'd have an issue replicating what the team did at the last ESCA, at the last ESCA LAN without me. Don't see why they can't do that again.
Okay, so let's give you best case scenario. You guys get some boot camping in. You guys get a lot of practice in. Next major gets announced. Whatever, I don't know where it would be or whatever. But next $250,000 tournament shows up. You guys get an invite. Realistically, do you think that you'll be able to do better now than what iBUYPOWER has done in the past? Like, really confident in that? Like, give me a number here.
Between.
Like, what place do you think you would get at a major?
Oh, first.
First place. So you're going from zero to hero. Is that what you're telling me?
Not even making adder groups to champions.
That's what you're telling me right now.
I don't know, man. We'll have to wait and see. Talking to Steel or are you talking to Josh right now?
I'm not even doing this game again. So next question. We've already talked about your team a lot. We've talked about complexity. What's your thoughts on the rest of the NA scene and players and teams? Anybody else out there you think worthy?
I think there are players, there are individuals that could do well, but I don't know enough about the players, their personalities, their goals, their I don't know how long they've been playing for. I don't know how quickly they're progressing. I don't know how quickly they're learning.
Can I make this easier for you really fast?
Sure.
What about your former teammates from last season?
Mozbeck's team, Ronin 5?
Yeah.
I only know Mozbeck. I don't know if Neil's still playing. I don't know if Frost isn't playing.
Frost is gone. It's just Mozbeck, I guess.
So Mozbeck. So Ronin 5.
Yeah. What's your thoughts?
I don't want to go into this, really.
Yeah, you do.
No, I'm pretty sure I don't.
Okay. I'm done. I'm not going to make you do it.
Okay.
I'm just, because that's the only person I know that you know that you've played with, so you know how they are. Because you're making this point where I don't really know, like, I know individual players. I don't really know teams. And so I was trying to give you, like, a person you actually played with. Because that's actually the only player left that you did play with last season that still plays. So that was really the only person you could have gave a good read on, in all actuality. So that's why I did that. It wasn't just to try to bait you. It was literally that's the only person left that you played with that still plays. So I tried. I tried, chat. I tried really hard for you guys. I even gave a logistical reason why. It was a no-go. Gave it a shot. Mediocre Gamers, they have talent. D-Born, Rikanji, all those guys.
Mediocre Gamers, as the only team that's beaten us so far, is the only team that's really surprised me or kind of stood out. I think that of all the teams, I think they have the most potential. Just because it looks like they have the right leadership and they have the right mix of like gamers and new players coming in, where like Irkanji and D-Born can kind of give them something to work with, give Shroud, like Shroud's one-shotting people, I hear, but he doesn't have like much experience, doesn't have LAN experience from what I'm told.
Right.
So if he's able to learn from the older players, then I think they have potential as a team. Beyond that, like United 5, good group of players, been around for ages, but they've been around for ages is also the same issue that they have, is that they old, basically. They old.
So, So you don't see, so basically, are you telling me that you don't see any other international contenders in North America besides you and Cole right now? Is that what the basic summary of this is?
I think the next teams that would be up there would maybe be like mediocre gamers. I think they have the potential, and they have people that have like the experience, like from international events. Beyond them, though, I mean, I don't think any of the other teams would. Domestically, they can do well. Internationally, they'll need some experience. Like it's a whole different feeling completely. As you can't really put it into words how different it is. It's completely different from anything they would have seen at ETS or SoCal Revival or ESEA, and it's just completely different entirely.
So I'm actually going to get some viewer questions here for a little bit, but what I was going to ask is, besides ESEA LAN, I'm sure you guys would look to go to another major if one came about, but I mean, are you guys interested in any of these North American LANs, like the Iron Gaming, like the GoRG in Vegas, you know, are these events that you might do?
We would we're definitely interested in them. We need to figure out which ones we can all attend, which ones make sense for us to attend as a team. I think that we have our eyes on Iron Gaming. I don't know about the others, obviously ESEA, obviously whatever next biggest European LAN is, but I haven't spoken to the oh. This is awkward.
Why are you shrinking?
I don't know. Hang on.
Did your chair just
Yeah, my chair just
derp all
fell
over the
apart.
place?
Yeah.
Nice.
Okay, so
I would just notice you slowly, like, you're just like, oh. My chair can't
So
even do that. Anyway.
yeah, basically anything that makes sense for us to go to, we'll start to go to. But beyond that, I haven't spoken to the rest of the team about anything that's happening in like the near future about what's going on. So we'll have to just see what we decide to do as a team.
Right, so I'm waiting for some viewer questions, but so far all of them are trolls, so I don't think you want to answer troll questions today. There was one really funny one though, but it was really mean too.
What is his favorite color and what does he think about
That
Mosbeck?
was like really sneaky, right? That was so sneaky. Oh, you're reading chat yourself, so I don't even
Of
have to.
course. I love reading the chat.
What is your favorite color?
Blue.
What do you think about Mosbeck? I tried, boys. I tried. I tried. All right. I'm done. See, I don't have a problem with them, but everyone wants to hear you talk about it, so that's the only reason why I'm giving what the viewers want, man.
Is this the viewer ask questions show or is this the
Yeah,
hype?
it is the hype, but I always have a segment at the end where I let viewers ask questions. This always happens. I always
The
have. I,
anti-hype.
yeah.
God damn it.
So
Okay.
people are asking questions about Shroud. Do you think he'll ever find himself on a top team? I mean, I
No
think
idea.
no
Don't
idea.
honestly, I came back into the scene and I see all these like forum posts and whatever about Shroud like being god of the game. I honestly haven't really looked into it too much. I haven't watched him stream. I've seen a clip here and there, but honestly don't know enough about the guy's personality. I don't know how he is as a teammate. I don't know, like I haven't analyzed his gameplay. I can't tell. I don't know.
That's fine. So someone asked, will the streaming continue once you get back to Canada? Is that something that you want to grow? I think you already kind of said this, but
Yes.
there you go. So another question comes in that was actually really good. Do you think that the rivalry now between Complexity and iBUYPOWER is bigger than it ever has been? Is there a new element now to this rivalry that you guys have always had?
Probably.
On a
Probably. We've
personality level or on an actual skill level?
I think like at the start, Complexity was beating iBUYPOWER domestically, and now that's kind of flipped. So I think there's that rivalry that's kind of emerged. There's the rivalry between Swag and former team now. Like he left them. He's now playing with iBUYPOWER from Complexity. So there's that little bit of whatever you want to call it. There's the me versus anger one rivalry. There's DaZeD versus ex teammates. If that's a even a what the fuck is going on?
Dude, your
That's
chair
even
is just not.
I know. I just keep sinking, man. It's like the
I
Titanic.
can't handle your
Anyways,
ego.
there's You know
Come on,
this
that
room
was funny. Come on, that was
is
funny.
actually 10,000 square feet.
What was the point of that?
It's my ego takes up most of it.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Continue.
I thought that was kind of straightforward, but
Oh, I missed it. Yep, right over the head.
right over
Right
the
over.
head.
Right over. Right over the bowl cut, baby. If you can't beat
Baby,
him, you gotta
baby,
make fun of yourself,
baby,
right?
baby.
Anyway,
Or
go
get a
ahead.
haircut.
Yeah, I did last ESCA land. People didn't like that either, so what the fuck ever.
Hey, it's like a lose-lose situation. Welcome to my world.
Yeah, I'm gonna get another one before the next land. I think every
Right.
land I'll just get a new hairstyle and see until one works out. Anyway, continue.
Rivalry, yes, probably. Next question.
People are asking for your Twitch account. It's just steel_TV. Ask about MOSFET again. I'm done, guys. It's over. Let it go. Let's see here. I'm trying to think of see, there's no from chat, man. You guys are all being a bunch of trolls. So you talked about a little bit of how you want to get into casting matches and stuff like that, especially like the European ones. How do you foresee that going? I mean, would you be trying to work with other people, or would you just be trying to like do a solo stream by yourself? Like, what are kind of your plans for trying to add on to that that streaming aspect?
I'd have to do it with someone else, most likely. Solo casts are ridiculously unenjoyable. Your mouth and throat just dries up. You have no one to bounce ideas off of. You need to make sure like you need to cover all the quiet moments and everything. It's just shitty doing it solo, so I definitely want to do it with someone
Yeah, that's
else.
what I've been doing for the past 3 weeks.
For
So
shame, for
I'm trying to
shame.
make it work, but yeah, I understand where you're coming from on that.
Yeah, so obviously I'd do better as a color commentator, but at face it, there were a few rounds where I actually picked up and did the play-by-play casting as well. It's just I don't think my vocabulary on the fly is big enough to kind of compensate for such adventures. I think analyzing is definitely the way to go for me,
So what do
but.
you think makes you such a good observer, and what do you think about, like, did you enjoy doing the observing? I know it's kind of behind the scenes work, so you don't really get, I guess, the exposure or credit. I don't know how you would label it, but I mean, what do you think about that? Like, how did you get into it? What do you enjoy about it? Why do you think you're better than auto director? Like, why do you think that's the case?
Auto director mainly focuses on who's getting the next kill, and I'll switch to them before they get the kill, so you see that kill. But if there's one person that gets a kill somewhere and then someone gets a kill somewhere else, like a few seconds after that, auto director will only find one of those. So what I do is I'm just staring at a map, looking at the numbers, and then when I see that it's, these two people are about to engage and these two people are about to engage, I click on one, the person I think who's going to get the kill first, and then when they get the kill, I switch over to the next person right away. Auto director doesn't switch it that fast. I guess that's why people say I don't miss any action, because I'm manually switching it to the next where the next action's happening. The next thing is anyone who streams, they just kind of like let auto director do the thing, and then they just talk about what they see on the screen. What's happening on the screen though? Like you don't know what the fuck's happening on the screen. If you don't have someone to analyze it, really. So if you have two play-by-play casters kind of going at something, and they're talking about a bunch of bullshit that doesn't actually have any effect on the game. They're just blowing smoke. I like to pull up the overlay, show what's going on somewhere. I was working on some like shitty ass desk with I don't even know what kind of mouse it was, so I couldn't even draw his proper boxes or anything like that. It was just like all sloppy. But if I see something that's happening, either a setup of smokes, a set execution, or I see someone who's doing like a lurking play that auto director won't find because they're not actually killing anyone, but they're about to make a kill or they're setting up a fake. Like it's always good to have that information just because you can see why teams are reacting in certain ways. Like you can see the CT team rotating off of a bomb site, but you don't know why because you're just watching from the perspective of the person who gets the kill, as opposed to from the perspective of someone who's throwing a fake and kind of going around making a bunch of noise and then, you know, showing what's actually happening, showing that strat actually unfold. Sometimes it doesn't matter who gets some kill because it's an eco frag. You want to see the important bits of the round, and sometimes the actual tactic is more important than a singular frag. Obviously, kills are where all the action is, but you want to see, you want to think about the game more as opposed to just seeing people shoot other people. Like, go watch a fucking deathmatch or something, if that's the case.
So I had a viewer question come in asking, do you think that, like, things will ever get big enough to where a team like yourself in North America could ever, like, receive salaries or a gaming house like you see some of these pro-European teams get?
Yeah, it's possible. And I don't think it's going to happen for probably another, I'd say, at least a year. We'd need to see these 250K tournaments coming to North America first. That's first thing. When that happens and you have the viewership coming to America, that's when organizations will see the ROI coming. And they'll say, you know what, we pick up a team, we put this much money into them, we get these sponsors, the sponsors will get this much back out of it, we can afford to salary them and stuff. That won't happen unless there's more frequent tournaments or bigger tournaments coming. And I think that's slowly starting to happen. We are seeing like Iron Gaming, SoCal Revival, this Vegas LAN. So there's more opportunities. It still needs to grow further. If there's like one or even two Valve tournaments in North America in a span of a year, I think that's when we'll start to see it grow and we'll start to see salaried teams, bigger and better. Like EG still has yet to come into the scene. And I don't think they're going to come unless they have like 250K tournaments where, you know, 250,000 people are watching.
Right. So I had another question coming. This will actually be the last user question before I let you go. So I know you got to get to practice here soon.
I see a good question here. Still, why didn't you pursue more acting opportunities after American Pie? Actually, I wasn't in American Pie. I was in, let's see where this is. I was in Canadian Pie. And if you can tell, this is actually me. So,
that's real life?
This is me. This is Canadian Pie. What?
I have never heard of this in my life. What?
You haven't heard of Canadian Pie, man?
No, I feel like I'm getting trolled so hard.
I'm not trolling. Why would you think I'm trolling? Hold I never
on a
troll.
Second. You're a liar. Right.
Okay. I'm a liar.
You're a liar when you say that you've never trolled. You have definitely trolled.
I never troll. I don't.
Okay, I'm done.
Never
okay,
troll.
So actual another question that came in besides the one that you saw was, what do you think is like you were talking about Sean Gares earlier as being like a really good in-game leader and stuff like that. What do you think kind of separates the two of you, as far as maybe skill level as an in-game lead, like philosophy, like what do you think about, how do you compare one another?
I honestly, like, I haven't played with the guy. I haven't really listened. I've only heard him calling from like the team speak at EMS1, for example. So I know that he kind of talks and tries to get input from the team by asking them questions like, what do you want to do here? I know that he'll say like, oh, this team does this and this and this a lot, so what we're going to try to do is this. So he explains what the enemy team does and how you're going to beat it, and then he tells what role everyone has to do for that. So in that respect, I think he's good, but it's mainly watching it from an observer perspective. If you look at how the team sets up and then executes the tactics and is like all together, kind of, I don't know if that's Sean Gares as a leader, or if that's just the team, their individual play styles kind of complements the tactic that they're running, but it looks like it's working. Like they go to Europe and they do well. So I can only take from it. They do well. It looks like they're organized as a team in terms of tactics. They're kind of in the important positions that they need to be in. I can only attribute it to the leadership there. Now with me, right now it's mainly like we haven't had time to set up set strats, so it's kind of like on the fly decision making. But even then, like when I'm playing and it's 3 a.m., I can't really think too well. I can't talk too loud because my flatmates are sleeping. I don't want to wake them up. So it's difficult for me at the moment to kind of micromanage when I need to. So I know that days picks up a lot where I should be doing it. So I think that once I get back to Canada and I can actually talk again and I can be fully awake when I'm playing, that's going to be kind of our true test to see how well I'm doing and if we want to change anything.
All right, man. Well, I think that that's about it. I know you got to get to practice here pretty soon for your team. I don't want to hold you up too much longer. And with the interview already been about 2 hours almost, so it's definitely really insightful. But do you have any last comments or shout outs or anything you want to get out there before you step away?
I don't know if I should say this.
Oh my God.
No. I'm done. I've said everything that
you can't
needs to
tease
said.
The people like that. Dude, you can't walk away from my show saying I got something.
You know what? It's already gonna be a big enough splash. There's already gonna be enough hostility towards me and others because of this. There's enough hype that's been laid. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for inviting me onto the show. Remember to follow me on Twitter so I can openly roast people and create drama on Twitter flame wars, because we all know that's what I'm good at. And that's it for me, man.
Shout out to your sponsors. Any sponsors you want to shout out to?
At iBUYPOWER on Twitter. You can go iBUYPOWER.com. I don't know what like my teammates. Let's look at the ESCA page. Why don't we and find out. I mean, my teammates, thanks for the opportunity for playing with you dudes. And Astro, HyperX, and Western Digital.
There you go. What a great poster boy you are, man.
I know, right?
All
right,
man. Well, have a good one. I'm sure I'll be chatting with you. And thanks for coming on the show, man, because it's really the guests that make this show, not me. So I really appreciate you taking the time to come out, man, and giving some insight that we otherwise would not have gotten.
Cheers.
Cheers, man. Peace.